Observer A1108. behind the phone, when two people got over the rattle, and they told me that my wife was being taken into hospital in the final stages of the disease. I went back to my office and sat away my partner to tell him that Mark was very ill. When he asked me what was wrong with him, I did not say, because I was afraid that the others in my office, hearing that only so many names, would associate me with it. I went to the men's toilet and cried. On the day he died, the same mutual friend called me at work and asked me to meet her outside her office. She told me that she'd been with him that morning when he died. We stood in the corridor and both cried, and when one of the colleagues asked her to ask what was wrong, she said that Mark had been run over by a car and had died after being in a coma. Her colleagues were both suspected, but later one of them heard in the sat on seat, serving as a sat on seat and her boyfriend, what had really happened. When she came to work the next day, they moved the bed to the far side of the room and refused to speak to her. One man had told her he missed contact with her and sat children. She left her job shortly afterwards. So, apart from expressing his fear of being overheard in the office when he called his boyfriend, this mass observer does not say directly how he felt about Mark's death and what happened to this mutual friend. He describes crying twice, but not what he felt. A complex knot of emotion might well have fueled those tears. Grief at the loss of Mark and of his friends, a sense of isolation and not being able to share this news openly, fear, perhaps, for himself. As he wrote these words, he may also have been recalling feelings he experienced 2 weeks after Mark's death, when a passerby at Heathrow Airport called him a filthy AIDS queer and received and kissed his boyfriend goodbye on the cheek. Now, there's no certainty to my emotional guesswork. Inhabiting and understanding one's own emotional life can be hard enough. Trying to comprehend the emotions of people in the past feels like grasping at the truth of shadows. The people in the testimony share an apparently straightforward language of emotion, but one, of course, that's familiar with us too. But words like hate, fear, and love can be and might relate to different things in different historical contexts. At any historical moment, they describe and also evoke a range of thoughts and feelings. Different dimensions of fear were probably experienced by Mark as his illness developed, by his friends, to whom Mark must observe them, by their partners, and by the office mates he expected to check his children to come. Emotions were experienced and expressed differently, depending on where these people were standing in relation to the crisis and those most directly affected by it. Unlike many of his fellow and largely heterosexual and normal mass observer, that would be their words, mass observer A118 seems reticent in using emotions directly to describe what happened. His testimony is in this sense rather flat, and his sense of restraint or containment in his simple, descriptive prose. But this is significant of it, and might relate, again more guesswork, to the necessity felt amongst gay men and allies at this time to hide in general view the grief, anxiety, anger, guilt, shame and other emotions experienced in the context of serial loss and anti-gay backlash which traded in blame and fear. But is revisiting ever done suggests that such negative feelings are like exes marking the spot where the social is at work on it. Intense, exhausting grief and enduring anxiety were perhaps difficult to articulate amidst the loud proclamation that gay men were getting their just deserves. This dominant emotional pulse was sustained through the threats, through pronouncements of self-appointed moral guardians, and often vocal members of parliament and local government, and through everyday jokes, action and interaction between ordinary people. This is what gay And neither prohibit local authorities from promoting homosexual gay attended family relations, which tabled in Parliament in 1987. It passed into law in Section 28 of the Local Government Act in the following year. So these were some of the contexts in which Mass Observer A1108 was writing. And in what followed, I want to turn the emotional threads of his testimony through other Mass Observer responses and through other archival collections I explored to show an interweaving of language and emotion in this particular journey. These are the collections I was looking at and the archives in which they are held. They were saturated with emotion, sometimes articulated and sometimes not. They can even occupy the encounters amongst the most moving I've ever had, page after page of some heartbreaking, disturbing, sometimes infuriating writing which I found hard to navigate, or to know quite how to communicate, partly because this is one of the personal issues too. In 1989, I finally came out after much hesitation on account of its wider climate. A year later, in 1990, I hit London. So these connections touched a particular nerve for me as I recounted in this research, as I reconnected in this research with the social, cultural, political context of my early adulthood, and the potent mix of pride, anxiety, and excitement with which I embarked on my new gay life in capital. My fearful parents cautioning me by phone about the contaminations of London for gay men as homophobic attacks were on the rise alongside age-related deaths. It made me thoughtful about the emotional relationship that I and historians and researchers more broadly have with our work. The experience reminds me too that however difficult emotions in the past are to deal with and to interpret, however tempting it is to sideline them, they are, as my former colleague Joanna Bourke has argued, at the heart of the solid experience and a motor of social change. Emotions are never only personal, they're fundamentally relational, and in relationship with others in their society, and they are woven into a sense of voice, want, and persuade in a multitude of places, from the domestic to the fates and chambers of Westminster. I tried to illustrate this broad point by charting the emotional landscape around 1987, taking my cue from Mass Observer A118's testimony, of which we see highlights. And so I want to look at the general mood of anxiety about HIV and AIDS as opposed to specific fears. I want to look at the disdain and repulsion for gay men and the allies which we saw in this row. I want to look at empathy for atheists and victims which we saw in Mark's friends. I want to look at fear for children on the part of parents especially in poverty. And I want to look at horror, anger, shame and pride, elements in which we might just live between the lines themselves quietly and resisted. Now, in particular, the serious act itself did it as criticism and a condition of accessibility. But he came there, unless he has moved against such conditions vocally and visibly, in the 1970s, a song to gain information from 1974, for example. In the past 1980s, however, and in the context of the AIDS crisis, the stakes were much higher. Of necessity, it was the health crisis, and as a result, the related and growing fine protest movement and the equality agenda of some left-wing councils gave men and lesbians without trespassing further on public attention, public space, and in their health and social care needs on the public purse. So it has angered gay men, not only because of the alarming threat they posed to the AIDS, but because of the ways in which they were, often related reasons, failing to support themselves, either quietly or with dignity, and were becoming more visible and demanding in this year. Levin, writing in the Times newspaper, condemned the galloping frenzy of hate against homosexuals in his 1987 movie. But he went on, a minority of homosexuals abused the new freedom that the 1967 sexual events had offered by flaunting themselves in an extravagant, bootstrap mode of behavior, well calculated to disrupt homosexuals, including many who were sympathetic. They caused resentment because the aggressive Tony Abbott campaigned for their rights, elected by hard left local councils. Notice the dance here of hate, disgust, resentment, and loss of sympathy he choreographed, but also a pressing sense of the direct as well as fleeting danger being then posed. The piece appears under a headline being engaged with the Gestapo. Just should be noted that Slav Tari would be prosecuted in France for the war crime atrocity that he had committed. Another journalist, Ray Hancock, had made similar pleas of toleration upon sexual material, but warned then that diehard gays were using their erect penises as weapons of war. Sexually, danger and selfishness of gay men and their allies ran through a number of mass observation testimonies. In its championing of Floor 28 and Border Wrestling, the Thatcher government was meanwhile attempting some containment by re-articulating the idea of its own limited tolerance while trouncing the idea of white rights and equality. Now it's easy to draw out the most impassioned and shocking testimonies and reports from the mass observation of media interventions. Such testimonies can suggest an emotional pitch which is not sustained across all testimonies, across all media, or amongst all MPs. These feelings begin circulating in print and in everyday conversations and signal something across what is both possible and permissible to say and to do. They have currency in themselves, but they're important too because they prompt others, gay and straight, to push back, but often unemotionally. Divisions between gay and straight, and national conservatives of both loonies on the left and quoting, were dramatised in the press and more articulated collectively in some testimonies. Overall, the mass observation sample and the British Social Attitudes Survey showed that women tend to be potentially more empathetic than men, and those who have grown up in the 1960s tended to be more tolerant than their elders. Yet Simon Watley wrote at the time, lives will barely live in these polarities. Relationships with friends, family and work colleagues frequently come across those various divides as people muddle through in their everyday. The emotional problems resonated widely nevertheless and created a self-consciousness even for those who rejected the prevailing divisive assumptions of rhetoric. We see something of this in a 47-year-old woman's description of her gay neighbours. The woman at work with Thank you. Dance between differently invested and engaged people in one Let me add another. He wrote that associated